The Biden Infrastructure Week is finally here. It had become like the big political joke, Infrastructure Week. But Biden comes in and a couple of months later, it's actually happening. He's rolling out his plan, although you're gonna wanna take a look at the details because it's not necessarily the plan that we had been expecting. You know, about 8 days ago, we had found out from the New York Times that he was preparing a $3 trillion infrastructure spending plan. Just yesterday, Business Insider reported that they were gonna bump the price tag up to $4 trillion. So, ooh, it's getting bigger with every passing day. Oh, nope, it's here, it's $2 trillion. So I don't know what happened since yesterday, but it's half the size that it once was. It's moving in the exact opposite direction that all of us are during the pandemic. But anyway, it has gotten a bit smaller. And so that's what we have. So we're gonna give you the details. But first of all, Brett, what do you think about the number that they landed on?
It's like watching Bitcoin right now. I don't know. I had a huge FOMO when people were like making billions off of Bitcoin. And I felt bad, so I bought like $100 worth of Bitcoin. And it goes down and then it goes up. And it's doing that while you're watching it. It's like that, except with, you know, instead of seeing if I'll have $102 or $104, it's like, will I be able to drive on American roads or not?
Yes.
What a lot of us are missing is how fun this is. When you're talking about like doubling or halving the size of the investment in America's infrastructure. Isn't it fun?
Yeah. It's so fun to think about like, will there be bridges? Maybe. Will there be half as many bridges as there could be? Tune in to find out over the next decade. Anyways, that's sort of our response. A lot of progressives are not pleased with this. AOC tweeted, this is not nearly enough. The important context here is that it's $2.25 trillion spread out over 10 years. For context, the COVID package was $1.9 trillion for this year alone, with some provisions lasting 2 years, needs to be way bigger. Yes, it is very small in comparison to what we've been doing in regards to the pandemic. And as you'll see, it's talking about a lot of different areas of the American economy and infrastructure and healthcare. So when it's doing all of these different things for the number to be lower than it was supposed to be literally 24 hours ago, not necessarily a great sign, which is not to say that there aren't good things in it. There are, and we're gonna cover some of the big ones. First of all, it plans to invest about $2 trillion over the next 8 years, which is about 1% of America's GDP per year over that time. So another way to look at it, not that huge. Most of it involves upgrading America's roads, bridges, and public transit, but it also expands long-term care for the elderly through Medicaid, bans exclusionary zoning, and invests in community-based violence reduction programs, among many other things. And there are a lot of things. Like $621 billion in infrastructure spending dedicated to rebuilding the nation's roads, bridges, ports, and rail systems. $300 billion to bolster manufacturing, $213 billion for affordable housing, $380 billion for research and development. I guess just in general, I don't know. Modernizing America's electricity grid, installing high-speed broadband around the country. $400 billion for home and community-based health and elder care. Little things that I like to see, like investing $174 billion in the electric vehicle market, including building out a network of 500,000 EV chargers on roads over the next 9 years. That's significant. I have a lot of criticisms, but that's certainly significant. It also notably, and there should be more coverage of this, eliminates all lead pipes and service lines in drinking water systems and puts $56 billion in grants and flexible loans to states, tribes, and territories to upgrade drinking wastewater and stormwater systems. So the idea is we're gonna get rid of the lead in the water, finally, across the country. So that's good, Brett. A lot of good things here. What are your thoughts?
My thoughts are, exactly what you pointed out proves that we don't have enough information about this, and there will be time to get that information. And in the meantime, progressives are saying it's not enough, right? Which is fine, and like the default position that we should have and should be expected based on experiences with government spending and investment in underserved areas, right? So this is a good position to have. When you say that it fluctuates between when everybody says that it fluctuates between $2 and $4 trillion over the course of a week, just underscores how little information that we have. Maybe the original plan was 8 years and then, or 16 years, $4.9 trillion or $4 trillion, and now it got halved to 8 and 2. We don't know yet. The other thing is no one knows what anything costs really ever. Okay, so it's weird to me to hear, or at least it, you need a more developed like invoice with line items and costs if you're gonna criticize it, right? So I and we don't have enough information to know if that criticism is valid yet, because right now it's literally press releases from the people who want you to like it. Okay, so there will be time, it must be monitored as it progresses. But in terms of those subject areas and those line items, I like the priorities. I like the priorities being, we gotta build roads, we gotta build broadband. You know, we have to, in the same way that building the railroads in the Industrial Revolution was very essential for America to develop as a nation economically, even though they did it by terrible, terrible means. We need to lay that fiber now to take us to the next level. And we need to build the roads because we still, you know, even though the cars might not have drivers in them, we need to get stuff from place to place. So I like the priorities and definitely getting the lead out once and for all.
Check out the Damage Report podcast each day, wherever you get your podcasts, whether Pocket Casts or Stitcher or iTunes. You can join me as I give you the news and stories you want, with a range of co-hosts and interview guests jumping in on the fun each day. Again, that's the Damage Report, wherever you get your podcasts. And if you get them at iTunes, don't forget to rate and review. Sometimes I'll read them live on the show.